Heart Research Center presents part two of A Trip into the Supernatural with best-selling author Roger Morneau. In part one of this exclusive interview, Roger Morneau told about his experiences with Satanism as a young man. Joining him again in part two are Cyril and Cynthia Grossi, who helped Roger break away from the power of darkness to discover a loving God. Conducting this interview are Dan and Karen Houghton of Heart Research Center. Let's now watch the conclusion of A Trip into the Supernatural.
We continued and we continued to give him Bible studies with the smoke and all. And we got down to the Bible study where health died in health.
Body temple.
Body temple. And he was fascinated with that. And so we finally told him that, I think there's a text that when men turn away from God, they turn to the bitter weed.
Bitter herb.
Or herb or something. So we like the bitter herb too. Tobacco and so on. He was fascinated with it. And he says, well, why didn't you tell me that you didn't smoke?
I think what really got him was the, when he read, know ye not that your body is a temple of God, and if any man defile a temple of God, him will God destroy. And so he asked me, what do you mean by that? So my reply was, well, let's take the church. We all respect the church. Would you take a cigarette into the church and smoke it? He said, of course not. Then I said, would you take alcohol into the church and drink it? He said, no, that would be silly. And so by making those comparisons, finally I said, your body is the church. Your body is the temple. He said, am I smoking? I said, right. He said, why didn't you tell me this on the first night? I said, if I had told you this on the first night, you wouldn't come the second night. He said, you know, that's right. So you can see where patience is a virtue. If you use patience and take your time, it pays off.
He told us that he realized he was getting into demon worship to the point where it was scaring him. He was frightened. And he prayed a prayer to God, even though he didn't realize it, and it wasn't with all the trappings that Christians usually use, but he said, if there is a God in heaven, help me. And at that time, you were an answer to his prayer.
That's right.
But also, wasn't he an answer to your prayer?
He certainly was. When Elder Taylor got to the point in his Bible studies of speaking about the Sabbath, all of my background, I was born in Halifax, Cynthia was born in Montreal. All of my background was Baptist and some Methodist. And I couldn't see going to church on Saturday instead of Sunday. In fact, I would laugh at my wife for quite some time, even as a child, that the fact that she was going to church on the wrong day. But getting back to the point is, when we were taking those Bible studies and Nellie Taylor got to the Sabbath question, he proved it. Yet I didn't believe it. And there's a point in your studying the Word of God that you want to stay with tradition rather than go with the truth. And I wanted to stay with tradition. But at the same time, the truth was pulling me back to the point where I said, I didn't even tell Cynthia this. Lord, if you want me to keep this Sabbath, let me, with the knowledge I have, win one soul. And if I do this, I know that it will be a sign. And not long afterward, I met Roger, sat down beside him, and he asked me for Bible studies. I know it was a sign. I'm here today.
What part did Cyril's conviction about the Sabbath truth play in you being confronted by Christ with these eternal realities? So I understand that he wasn't even a baptized Seventh-day Adventist. He was baptized the first Sabbath you went to church. But what if he had not been convicted of the Sabbath and had told your Jewish boss that he would be willing to work on the Sabbath?
Well, I would lose out on eternity, I believe. I would have lost hope.
So his conviction was part of the process that Christ used to confront you.
But there's more to this. He was working for a nice, a real nice firm, embroidery firm. And he was studying the Bible with Pastor Taylor, and Pastor Taylor had brought him now to the point where he said, you should observe the seventh Sabbath if you're going to, you know, serve the Lord all the way. Serve the Lord, serve him all the way. The Lord says, if you love me, keep my commandments. The fourth commandment says, remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. And the Lord says, why he wants us to keep it holy? Because he's God and we're the creatures, and that we ought to be counting our blessings, so to speak. Now, Cyril was pondering this thing in his mind, and he said to himself, and he prayed about it, Lord, I want some kind of a sign that you're really with me in this, that you want me to start keeping the seventh Sabbath now. But Lord, there's something missing. I tell you what, if you make it possible for me to meet someone that doesn't know about the Sabbath, because not too many people know about it anyway, and that I'm able to convince him of the importance of the biblical Sabbath of creation, then he says, I'll know that you want me to start giving a Sabbath now, instead of next year or some other time. And do you know that prayer was answered in 2 weeks? We figured out a time, about a time that I said, there's a God in heaven that cares for me, help me. I think it's a couple of days after that he made a decision that, hey, Lord, show me. I know, you know, I just love, would like to enjoy the experience of knowing that you're listening to me and that you're doing something special for me. And I'm doing something special for you because I'm obeying your commandment.
So in reality, Roger, you were an answer to his prayers, before, while you were still a spiritist.
Mm-hmm. Cyril, did you and Cynthia know at this time when you were studying with Roger that he was involved at all with spirit worship?
You know, the Lord blessed us mightily. He blessed us with the fact that we were completely ignorant of anything. And I would not advise anybody to openly go and do something like we did with having the knowledge that this person is a devil worshiper, because no person has the power to overcome this on their own. But I feel very impressed that the Lord, the Holy Spirit, guided us, and our eyes were covered until a certain time that we could handle it.
And when was that time, Cyril? When did you discover that this man worshipped demon spirits?
We discovered that midway between the lessons, and I don't know exactly what point it was, but one night he came. And we had previously studied on the unpardonable sin. And he came with tears in his eyes, and he was very upset. And he said, he was upset, and he had books under his arm. And I said, well, what are you so upset about, Roger? Roger in French. And he said, well, you don't know what I've been doing. So I said, look, the Bible says all manner of sins will be forgiven. And he said, but you don't know what I've done. So after he told me what he had been doing, worshiping the devil and getting acquainted with devil worship and going very deep into it, he showed me some books, and when I opened one of the books and read some instructions on how to worship the devil, I closed it up. I said, I don't want to see this. And I said, but one thing I want to make clear. I said, if you had committed the unpardonable sin, you would not be here willing to study the Bible. And therefore, the scripture that says, all manner of sins will be forgiven, applies to you. I said, you must consider yourself forgiven, and you must forgive yourself. And we went on from there.
I didn't even know what a devil worshiper was. I think we were both very naive. And so I went along, and I said, well, I tell you what, we leave the fact whether the sin is pardonable or unpardonable to God, and let's finish the Bible studies. That was all of the information and knowledge that I had. And it wasn't until later. And then he began telling us, you know, a little bit about the troubles he was having. And I thought that was rather unusual, and we're being involved.
Now, Cyril, whenever you did learn, you and Cynthia, about this spirit spiritism business. Mm-hmm. You immediately had a question about whether or not it was real. You were really naive about that. Mm-hmm. Now tell us, you had some special dispensation, some special work with the police department there in Canada, and you had the ability to carry a gun. Is that right?
Yes, I had a permit to carry a gun. And when he told me that not only was he having these manifestations, he was also having, he heard footsteps walking down his hall. He lived at the end of a long hall, and his door was the only door down that hall. And the footsteps would stop at his door, then a rap would come to the door. And we were also having trouble with the union at that time, so when he told me about these rappings on the door, I said, "Oh, that's only those union people trying to come and get you."
Yeah.
So I said, I'll scare them away just the same as I scared them away when they came to get me. And so I had so much faith in the gun that, don't forget, I wasn't baptized at this time.
That's right.
I had faith in this gun. So I took my gun and we went to Rote's place, and we were laughing and talking and just having a jolly time. And at midnight, we heard the footsteps coming down the hall. I said, "Roger, put your hand on the doorknob and get ready to pull it open." And so with all the bravado that I could muster with a gun, I waited for the rap on the door, and there it came. And I don't know exactly how many times the rap came.
Well, first you opened the door, and there was nobody there.
Right.
And you said, now his color changed. The color of his face changed.
The color of his face changed?
Yeah, definitely.
Believe it or not.
He was expecting union people.
And there wasn't anybody there.
There was nobody there.
What was your emotion at that moment, Sarah? What did you, when that door came open?
And there was nothing there.
Well, his emotion, excuse me for jumping in here,
okay,
was that he was almost like, you know, a statue of salt.
That was your observation,
yeah.
Roger.
That's right. So I said, "Hey, let's sit down, man." I said, "You know, they're not going to harm us." So we sat down with Cyril, and we talked some more. There was no problem. And about 10 minutes later, the spirit knocked on my balcony door. And the glass was loose a little bit in there, and it rattled pretty bad.
And did he still have all the bravado?
By then, he jumped right out of his seat. Didn't you, Cyril? And he said, "Let's get out of here." You know, because he had knocked real hard.
Yeah. It was at that time I said, "Roger, I think it's time for me to get rid of the gun and get baptized."
Yeah, that's right. That made him make his baptized.
Well, I've heard of lots of ways the decisions are made, but that's probably one of the most unique I've heard, Cyril.
Dramatic, to say the least.
Yes.
We were like children dealing with something we had no knowledge about, and he protected us. And like I said, if anyone knows of someone who is involved in this, they can't do it alone.
Requires special prayer and protection.
And it requires the Lord to be the one to handle the situation. A man cannot handle the situation because the powers and principles that's involved in this, no man can withstand.
What gave you the sense that you now had an opportunity for salvation? What was it that told you had a chance?
Well, the Holy Spirit was inspiring me. The Holy Spirit was ministering to me the grace of redemption. And to be able to put it into words, I don't have this kind of a vocabulary, because it's a mystery type thing. The Holy Spirit recreates you as he ministers to you, you see? And cleans your mind and gives you understanding you see things in different light that you never thought about before. Life becomes a meaningful thing all of a sudden. And you'd be willing to die for it. You see, for what you've learned. Because that's what I said to myself. The second night when I went back home, I had about an hour in the streetcar to my place. I got home at 12 o'clock. I said, "Hey, if they do me in tonight, I have the beautiful experience of having learned these great, wonderful things about God." So on Wednesday night, there I had the first hope. I can't remember exactly what verse of scripture was, but this one here says, "He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God." You see, and you had to explain what it meant.
And you took that right into your heart.
Yeah.
Roger, during these 3 days, from Monday night, Tuesday night, to Wednesday night, What went through your mind regarding the spirits?
I knew that I was going to be worked over by the spirits, either through one of their boys or some accident or something, see. This is the way I felt, I mean. And I said, this is very unusual that nothing has happened yet. And I'm going home on Wednesday night again with another appointment for Thursday Bible studies at 7 o'clock.
Now, let me make sure I understand. You had missed Wednesday night spirit praise service. At which time you were supposed to have made your full commitment.
Yeah, I would have.
And you had been at a Bible study instead.
That is correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what happened next?
So I said, this will be the end of it. Wednesday night, I said, they'll have a praise session to the gods, and that'll be it. But nothing happens Wednesday night. Thursday morning, I was alive. And I went back for another Bible study. And that is four more. And by then, I realized that the Creator was taking care of things. Because these people never give God the glory. But they always refer to higher powers. They respect, they pride themselves on the fact that they respect authority. You see? So therefore, they recognize the Creator for who He is. And but of course, that the Master, fallen Lucifer, is just as smart as God is. And he's got it worked out, so he's going to have a kingdom to himself for eternity, and you know, you don't have to worry about things. So I realized that the power of God was intervening. Now I became a brave, see? And the Spirit of God gave me the strength to do that. Because I said that God gave me the strength to be able to die for these things that I just learned, see? And that's what happened. I got those Bible studies.
So you went ahead and went to a Bible studies on Friday night?
Yeah.
And then you kept your first Sabbath, didn't you? Tell us about your experience on Sabbath.
First, that evening, before I left, 11 o'clock, Cyril says, you enjoy the Bible studies? Oh, yeah, very, very much so. I said, tomorrow you people are going to church. He says, yeah. I said, interesting. He said, would you like to come with us? I said, yeah, because I had the Bible study on the Sabbath already. I said, sure. I'm still alive. And he said, what do you mean by you're still alive? Well, I said, you know, I'll see if I'm still alive. I'll be here. I'll do this or do that. But I knew what I'd said. I'm still alive. And he said, would you join us here and we'll walk to church? It's not that far. We'll and walk a few blocks, and be a nice day tomorrow. I said, yeah, sure, meet you here. And we walked to church, and we were welcomed at the door, and there was a rack of brochures on the walls. I walked over and looked at some of them, picked up a couple, put in my pocket, and we were from Sabbath school, and I thought it was great.
Roger, the Lord helped you get through the Sabbath day without smoking. How did you eventually deal with your smoking habit?
Well, I tell you, Pastor Taylor talked, you know, for quite a while. When it got to be about 7:15 in the evening, I was getting very distressed because I got a tremendous urge of smoking about an hour before. And I said, oh, I got to have a cigarette. I just can't stand it anymore. And as the pastor continued explaining what I had to ask him to explain, it was difficult for me. And as he left, I told Cyril and Cindy, I said, I'm sorry, but I got to smoke. And on the way home in the streetcar, I said to myself, this is going to be, excuse the expression, but a hell on earth to give up smoking. Then I said, no, it's not going to be, because I'm going to have help. I got to my apartment, and I opened a closed closet, and I had two cartons of cigarettes on the shelf. And I opened them up, and threw all the cigarettes, you know, all the packs were opened up, threw into the toilet and flushed it down the drain. And then I knelt by the little table that I had there with my Bible on it. And I had started to read that Crucifixion of Christ, which I have read for 45 years now, every morning. Matthew, the 27th chapter, verses 24 through 54. Every day, God willing, I always read it. Well, now I can have my devotions at night and I don't have to put the light on because I know it by heart, see. Mm-hmm. But there I place my trust and my life in the care of the Lord of Glory, who had shed his precious blood on Calvary to acquire the legal right to be able to redeem me from where I was and from where I was going. So that was the end of smoking. Never had a desire to smoke again. Mm-hmm. I told him to take the desire away to recreate me. I realized that he was a creator, he can recreate. Yeah.
Roger, as you came closer to making a full commitment to God, did the demons try to prevent you from making that commitment in any way?
Well, I didn't have to wait too long. During the week, the Spirit of God held back the demon spirit so that he could not have access to me. I realized that from Wednesday night on. Then, as I came home at midnight of that Saturday night, there was a note on my door from my buddy. And he said, "It is urgent that I talk to you tonight. I don't care if you call me in the middle of the night. But," he says, "I got to talk to you. We're having a terrible disaster. Facing a terrible disaster." So I said, "Well, Rollins, one must have gotten some real static, you know." Sure enough, first of all, I wanted to review something that we'd studied at night. So I had a book. They lent me a book, Cynthia and Cyril, and I opened the book up and I started to read. And there was a marker, a sheet of paper actually, that had been cut in half in there. And I had put it on the table. And the piece of paper started to levitate and move around the room. So it didn't bother me. I knew what was doing it. And then the sheet of paper came and stood about a foot above my book. Then it was slammed down on the book, and the book fell in my lap, and almost into the floor I picked it up. And I felt like telling the spirits, you know, buzz off. But I had understood that I would not again talk with spirits. I had made up my mind on that. So I picked up the book again, started to write, and then the spirit picked up the book and threw it across the room against the wall with tremendous force. So I decided, well, I'm going to go and phone my buddy, see what he's going to do. Now, there was a public phone in the hallway. I didn't want to use it. I went down to a diner or restaurant or just down the block. And I called him up. "How's things rolling?" He says, "Man," he says, "oh." He says, "Don't you care for my life, Morno? What kind of a friend are you? I've been suffering," he says, "since Wednesday," he says, "trying to get a hold of you. And," he says, "I've been waiting at your door. What time did you come home?" I said, "Come home at midnight." He said, "You're in real trouble. Because the high priest, as a spirit, appeared to him on Wednesday evening and told him that you were studying the Bible with some Christians. But you were not just studying the Bible with Christians. You were studying the Bible with Seventh-day Adventists, the people that the Master hates most on the face of the planet. How in the world did you get yourself involved in something like that? Don't you care for your life?" I said, "Sure. Beside that," he says, and he told me other things that the spirits had told, the high priest. So the conversation went on the phone for a while, and I said, "Now listen, it's not possible for me to explain to you over the phone what has taken place in my studying the Bible 4 hours per evening, you know, through the week. Why don't you come to see me tomorrow sometime, and I'll give you the reasons, the real reasons why I did what I did." He said, "Okay." So we made an appointment for sometime Sunday morning. And I went back after my phone call, I went back to my apartment. And then I decided I might as well get to bed. It's late. I get to bed. I was not soon in bed that the lights went on. I got up, went to the lights off. Get back to bed, the light goes on again. I said to myself, there's no use getting up, turning the lights off. They're going to put them back on again. So I'm going to decide to go to sleep with the lights on. So after a while, things start moving around the place. A picture on that wall goes and sticks itself on the wall. There's no nothing to hold it up. And the light that was on the table moved and stands in midair. It stays there.
Were you feeling afraid at this time?
Oh, no, not at all. No.
No,
because of the fact that, you see, you get, human beings get accustomed to a lot of things. And you get supernatural strength, either from good or evil. Mm-hmm. And the Lord was singing me through this thing. And I knew that I was going to have a terrible struggle somewhere along the way, somehow. And they were going to try to destroy me, no question about it. So after this nonsense had gone quite a while, I went on to sleep. Hey, I'm going to get my rest. I'm tired. I said, Lord, you know, bless the old guy. I was not old in those days, though. But I said, bless the fellows. I can get some rest from these spirits. And I went to sleep. And it woke me up about 2 o'clock in the morning again. And at 4 o'clock. Now, at 4 o'clock in the morning there, I sat up in bed. Pushed my pillow in the back. And I said to myself, what in the world am I going to do? Because the Lord doesn't clear them out from me. Then I got a thought that maybe the Lord just wants me to know from the spirits exactly how things are, how I'm standing with them. And I said to the spirit, you want to talk to me? The spirit said, yes, finally, I'm able to talk to you. What in the world do you think you're doing? You see, the Lord had held back even on the spirits, that the spirits could not talk to me. I realized that they were under a very special control. So I got to talk with the spirit. And I realized that he was a spirit counselor. Because he said, the master has tremendous plans for your life. Fame, honor, respect, wealth. Don't you value any of these things? I said, I want you to know, Spirit, that 10 days ago, I would have grabbed your offer. But now you're talking to a former spirit worshiper, and I'm educated to the reality of life, especially of the reality of eternal life. And I said, I'm not interested. For about maybe 2 or 3 minutes, maybe 4 minutes, and that's a long time, in a conversation, there was no response to what I had said.
It was like he was totally amazed by your courage.
Yeah. Then when the spirit spoke again, he had a tremor in his voice. In other words, you know when a person gets really desperate in a crisis situation, your voice changes. And it gave me the impression that he had a hard time expressing himself. And that was a very clever individual. Well, he said, we've worked for so long over the years to prepare you for the master's work. And what are you doing? You know, and things like that. And he told me, okay, you're turning down the offer of the master. I said, definitely. He said, from now on, he says, poverty will be the lot of your life. That is, he says, if you can manage to stay alive. And he says, that I doubt that you won't gonna have much of. He says, your days are numbered. I said, you know, Spirit, the high priest has mentioned about higher powers. Am I affiliated now with higher powers? And I said, I don't have to concern myself with you or your master or any of the other spirits because you're all losers. I am the winner. 100 million years of perfect life, recreated, translated, or resurrected body that I'll have. My years will be counted into the millions of years. If I take the offer of the master, what do I have? I'm 20 years of age. Ed, even if I live to be 100, how can you compare that to 100 million years? And I'll have all the gold that I want and the silver that you're offering me, and more. So I'm not a loser no more. I'm a winner. And the spirit says, will destroy you. And he laughed. He had this was frightening. For one time, he had this laugh that caused me to think immediately of the laugh that Nero, instantly, Nero must have had on his face when the lions were tearing the Christians apart. That's the thing. I said, this is the way that Nero must have laughed. When the lions were tearing Christians apart, you know, in the arena of the Colosseum in Rome. Yeah.
So how did the spirit finally leave, Roger?
They finally leave, almost took the door away with him. He left through the balcony door, and the door was slammed open. Yeah, open. And the doorknob almost went through the plaster in the wall.
Did he leave on his own accord?
I commanded him to. I commanded him in the name of the Lord Jesus to leave my place, to come no more.
And he left.
And he left. And instead of slamming the door shut behind him, like a person would, he slammed the door open as he went out, and it slammed into the wall of them. And the doorknob, Cyril may still remember, you could see the imprint of the doorknob in the plaster. I mean, the house was maybe 50 years old, so the plaster had been settled a long time.
You commanded the demon to leave by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
He left, slammed the door. Did you go back to sleep?
Yeah.
And then the next morning, your friend Roland came over.
Well, between that, I'd like to tell you a little bit more. I woke up in the morning, of course, and I said, my, time to get up. And my Bible, my night table was to my left as I was laying in bed. I put my hand on the Bible, and then I started to shuffle, you know, the pages like this. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about many things, and I was doing this. And all of a sudden, I opened the Bible wide open. And then I got thinking about it again, never realizing what I had done. I got up, and after I stretched myself out a little bit, I look at the Bible, and my eyes fell on this Isaiah, chapter of Isaiah, the prophet, and I got reading, and it was the experience of Ezekiah when Sennacherib, the great general of the armies of the Assyrians, had compassed about the city of Jerusalem, and he was telling Ezekiah that he might as well give up, open the gates, you know, you're not going to survive this because we've destroyed all the nations that we've gone through before getting here. And I was very impressed. The fact that Ezekiah took the letter that the general had sent him, and he went in the temple of the Lord and placed it before the Lord, and he talked to the Lord about the letter. You see? And asked for his protecting care and guidance. And when he had not yet returned to his castle, when as Isaiah came, the prophet, and he told, he says, the Lord has got a message for you. The way that Sennacherib has come, that's the way that he's going to return. And I love that prayer, that Ezekiah prayer. I memorized that. It was a beautiful prayer. Because I got, from that moment on, I got an inner desire to fortify myself with the Word of God. Because every time that I read the verse in the Bible that applied to my condition, I received encouragement and strength. And I said, this is what I need to do. I'm going to fortify myself with the Word of God. I'm going to memorize the Word of God. I'd write there, and then I took a piece of paper. I underlined those verses of the prayer of Ezekiel in red in the Bible. I wrote down on a piece of paper, put it in my pocket, my coat pocket. So when I traveled on the tramway, you see, I could memorize that. And I've done that now for 45 years, and I'm still memorizing things, you know. Because Elda says to me once, she said, are you still memorizing? I says, yeah. Why are you memorizing? You know so much of the Bible and everything. He said, well, I need some more. You gotta keep feeding yourself spiritually. Mm-hmm. And that was the blessing that it was. I saw there A beautiful deliverance. And then I read the rest of the chapter, and it shows that during the night, the angel of the Lord went out. So when the general and his officers woke up in the morning, they look over the camp, and all their soldiers were dead. And he took off for Nineveh before they were done in. And he went to the temple of Nisroch, his god, and Sennacherib. And while he was worshiping there, his sons came in and put a dagger in his back. And he fled to the land of the Arameans. I was very impressed with that. And I left the Bible open there. I had my worship. When my friend came over, the Bible was still there. So,
whenever your friend Roland came over, you had just finished your worship time and you had read this story about Sennacherib. Mm-hmm. What did he say? Did he feel agitated? Was he upset?
Oh, yeah. He came in and sat himself down and he said, "I can't believe it. Not of all people," he says, "not Morno would do a stupid thing like daring the spirits." No. He said, you're an intelligent man, Roger. You know, you got a choice. The high priest tells me that if you come to see him with me now, no problem. Everything is going to be straightened out of the spirits. He promised him that already. He got that assurance. And he said, "Let's do the right thing. Why gamble with your life?" I said, "Well, I'll tell you what. I don't feel like going to see the high priest. Now or ever." And we conversed about a number of things, and he said, "Well, I hate to have to tell you this, but seeing that you decided that you're not going to have anything to do anymore with the master and his people, I hate to tell you this, that the high priest told me that a price has been put on your life. A medical doctor, remember, gave me the name, has pledged $10,000 to have you done in."
How did you feel whenever you found out that you had a contract out on your life?
Well, it surprised me a little, but I had prepared myself for something worse. So that I didn't, it didn't bother me too much. Because, see, the strength of the Lord, the word of the Lord, was the Spirit of God was giving me strength.
Okay, was the presence of the Spirit of God evident to Roland there that Sunday morning?
As we talked, and now he decided that he was losing the battle. He became very nervous. And he got up and went to the door, put his head on the door, and we talked there. He says, "Morno, please, if it's not for your sake, do it for me. Do you realize what's going to happen to me if something happens to you? I don't know how they're going to treat me." I said, "Hey, man, let me tell you something. I got a suggestion for you. You come with me. I'll guarantee you all the protection that you need to live to a ripe old age. And beside that, I'll tell you what. You should go back and tell the high priest and all his boys to come to our church. I'll arrange for my minister to have 100 spaces there right off the center aisle." I felt like I'm making them an invitation. Well, he says, "Well, I would never say a stupid thing like that." He says, "Well, that's your responsibility." I said, no, things are settled. He lit a cigarette. And as he lit the cigarette, I saw his hand shake like this. And I said, "You're quite nervous." "Well, let me tell you," he says, "there's a power here, a presence that I'm not accustomed to. I'm very uncomfortable because there's a power here that makes me terribly uncomfortable." Well, I said, "You know what it is? It's the presence of the Spirit of God, the Spirit of the Creator, the Life Giver." And I said, "Every other power is subject unto that higher power. You're aware of that." "Oh, yeah." So that's the way that it ended. He decided to go.
He told you that you had a contract put out in your life.
Yeah.
How did you respond to him? He was nervous, but he said to you, you're walking under the shadow of death, Morneau. How did you respond?
I said, my friend, I've got some news for you. Not so much for you as it is for the high priest. And now the Spirit of God gave me very special righteous indignation. Have you ever heard of that terminology? That when I heard that they were going to do me in, with have me shot, I said, look, I got some news for the high priest and his boys. The day that they wipe me out and do me in will be the day that the life giver is going to pull the bread of life on all of them except the high priest. And there'll be dead cadavers there in the temple. And tell the high priest this: don't call funeral directors because they don't have enough, not ambulance, but what do you call
coffins?
No, the wagon.
Oh, hearses.
Hearses. I said you better call the fire department in Montreal. Then you pile them all up there, the whole 100 of them. I said this is what's going to take place. He said you're a fool. I said you think so? Let me show you something. Picked up the Bible, and I said, I'm going to tell you a little story. Make it short. He said, short, because he says, I'm going. I said, listen to this. I just read this morning. There's a man by the name of Hezekiah that believed in the Creator a few hundred years back. And let me tell you what happened to him. Sennacherib came with his armies, told him the story. He went before the Lord and prayed about it. And the Lord says, the way that Sennacherib came, that's the way he's going to go home. And during the night, 185,000 men were destroyed by the angel of the Lord. So I said, don't tell me that I don't know what I'm talking about. I said, I can assure you that if they put a bullet in me, they're all going to lose out. Because the Creator will remove the breath of life. And I felt as sure of that as if this was a prediction that I think the Lord would have backed up my word.
So how did he respond after you told him that story?
Well, he said, I guess he says that I've lost my time. Before we part, he says, I don't want to even shake your hand because you're not a friend of mine no more. I said, have it your way. If ever we meet one another anywhere in the city of Montreal, don't you ever look at me like you know me, because I'll ignore you and embarrass you, he says, wherever we are. He says, fine. No problem with that at all.
Now, Roger shared with you that his former associates that worshiped demons, that were part of that elite spirit worship group in Montreal, were very unhappy with him, as were the demonic powers, for studying, especially with Seventh-day Adventists.
That's right.
Did he ever share with you or tell you that there might be some danger involved for you?
He did tell us something that rather startled me. He said he got a call from somebody in that organization, and they threatened our lives, and they knew us by name. And of course, nobody followed him. And I had to assume that the powers of darkness were able to communicate to those people that worshipped what our names were. They knew our names. And the things, some of the events that followed were such that I attributed them to demon powers.
Cynthia, there was an event that was a little startling to you and to Cyril, and I know Roger was interested in it as well. You had a fire at your house shortly after the Bible studies were going on. Tell us a little bit about that.
Shortly after the Bible studies, we were living with my father at the time. So we had a very large front room, pretty large front room. And we were sitting in the room, and my brother came up, who had a little problem of his own. And they were using some cleaning fluid to get something off of a piece of clothing. And my brother suggested that it wouldn't burn, and that he wanted to try it out to see if it would or wouldn't burn. And since it was a very large room, I guess he felt that the fumes wouldn't be as concentrated as probably in a smaller room. So he just decided to light a match. And I guess the fumes didn't sink to the ground, but they had risen up to where we were sitting, and the fumes burst in the room at our waist, about our waist, mm-hmm. as we sat down.
They burst into flames?
Into flames. It burst into flames. The floor was never burned at all. It was just as 3 feet off the ground, I guess. Mm-hmm. And everybody disappeared. And Searle, he went downstairs to get a blanket. And my brother, he disappeared. I was in further into the room, near the window, which was on the front side of the house. And I said, well, it isn't going to stop, so I better do something. So I jumped up on the chair, which turned out to be a stuffed chair, so I wasn't helping myself by any means. Then I looked at the window, which was about 3 feet from me, and I said, well, if I was already on the third floor, and I said, well, I'll jump from the third, from the window onto the balcony, which was on the second floor. It was a very small balcony. So I looked at the window, and the curtains had started going up in flames. And I said, you know, I just might miss that balcony and hit the cement.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, no, that's not going to work. So I stayed there, and then I just became paralyzed. And the only thing that was working was my mind. And I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, I don't want to die. I just married a year, and my whole life is in front of me, and if you can see any way I can get out of here, please do something. And I waited, and I didn't get any answer. And pretty soon, as if somebody had hit me to knock me off the chair, the force of it, somebody said, jump now. Which meant no questions or any other kind of rationalizations I was giving it. And I bent down to start a sort of a broad jump. And at that side of the room, I was at least 8 feet from the door. And I got down, and between me and the door was a radio, a floor-length radio with a lamp on it. And when I got down, when I crouched down to make the broad jump, I was outside of the room before Searle came upstairs with the blanket. I don't remember how I got there.
You were just kind of moved.
It just moved.
And then what happened where you had just been?
The can of gasoline apparently was sitting.
It wasn't gasoline, it was naphtha.
Naphtha was right by the chair, and it blew right up, a big hole into the ceiling, just as I moved away. And my hair was burnt, all my face was burnt, and, well, not all, right around here. And my eyebrows were gone. And he asked me, he said, how did you get out of the room? Because by this time, the room was totally in flames. And I said, I don't know. I said, but I prayed. And I was there. He didn't need the blanket then.
The Lord answers our prayers in spite of what the devil may try to do to us, doesn't he?
After the fire, and we moved away, and we were getting ready to come to the United States, we, of all places, moved in with an Irish family.
In
a French neighborhood. Partying. They loved to party. But we stayed to ourselves pretty much, because we felt that we would soon be leaving the country anyway. And they turned out to be really nice people. But while we were there, we had several different things happen. Like, for instance, we would say our prayers and get in bed, and then the doors would start slamming and the windows would go up and the wind would come through the room, and it terrified us. And so we went to bed every day, every night, with our Bible under our pillow. We'd turn on the light and everything would be calm, like, you know, as you expect. And then this would happen for, it happened for a couple of weeks, and then another thing started. Dishes would act like they were falling out of the closets, and somebody was sweeping with a broom on a hardwood floor, and all kinds of different things, and I was terrified. I wouldn't stay in there, you know, at all.
Did this happen? Excuse me. Did this happen during the Bible studies, or you
no,
were giving?
No, this is afterwards.
Right after this.
We had a lot of things happen to us afterwards.
For a couple of months.
So you were harassed by
harassed.
The demonic spirits.
That's right.
For your role in bringing Roger to a knowledge of biblical truth for several months. How did it stop?
The powers of darkness don't really stop. The only way you can keep them in check is on your knees, prayer. I don't think anybody is immune to the problems that come about as a result of the devil's work. The devil is working against us full time. He knows his time is short, and there's no way of saying that, oh, he stopped. Because when you say he stopped, that's the time he's going to start. We still have problems today that we know that the devil is behind them. Many of the mistakes that we make, or that we think we make, we've been set up in most cases. And that's why the Lord wants us to pray without ceasing.
Has there ever been a time whenever you were experiencing a difficulty that you felt was the direct result of the demonic forces being angry with you, that you wished that you had never met Roger?
Never.
Yeah.
Never. I'd do it all over again. If the same situation occurred, I'd be willing to do it all over again. Life is not as important as eternity. And a soul is not, cannot be turned away because of your own fear or your own lack of courage. There will never be a time when I'd be sorry.
After the demon left you that Saturday night, did you have any more demon harassment over the next few months, or was it just over instantly?
No, it was not over instantly. Every night, the spirits knocked on the walls, knocked on the doors. I was awakened 2-3 times a night. But they were trying to reopen conversation with me. The Lord would not allow them to bother me in any ways, except that they tried to open to have communication with me. And that, it seems that the Lord, the Creator has given us freedom of choice. You can choose good or choose evil. You see, that's your prerogative. It's a freedom that he has given us, which is beautiful, freedom of choice. Well, of course, the enemy of the Lord says, hey, I want access to it. At least you can allow me to knock on the door. If he responds, you lost him. He's mine. So I knew that very well. And it went for 6 months that the spirits knocked every night.
Did you wonder why they were continuing to do that?
Oh, yeah. I said, hey, thank you, Lord. That's all you allowed them to do. You know, they would love to destroy me, bring the ceiling down and the whole building on me, for that matter. But I said, I figured to myself, this is the thorn in the flesh. See, I'd read 2 Corinthians. The Apostle Paul says, because of the abundance of the revelations that he had received from God and all that, he says, there is given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. You know, because a human fallen human heart just loves to think good of itself and becomes proud and vain and sin against its creator. And the Apostle Paul says, I'm going to pray about it. He said, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice, 3 times prayed about it. And the Lord told him, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Isn't that beautiful? So the apostle said, therefore, most gladly will I rejoice in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And I said the same thing to the Lord. Lord, if you want these critters to, you know, be after me all the days of my life and knock and wake me up every night, that's okay with me. That's the least I could put up with.
So when did it stop?
Well, one prayer meeting, the minister says, how's things going? He says, with your Christian walk. I said, sir, couldn't go any better. He says, I'm glad for you. No. This was after the prayer meeting, we're just leaving. And he said, No problem with the spirits at all, huh? Oh, the spirits, well, yeah, they're trying to open communication with me all the time. You knock every night, they wake me up. You do? How can you put up with that? there's no other way. Oh, no, no, he says, wait a minute now. He says, it's my fault I didn't tell you this. He says, the spirits have an open avenue to you that God cannot close. As long as you have in your place the literature that you, or some of the things that you had to do with spirit worship. Do you have anything like that in your place? Oh, yeah, I got 3 books. Then I got some incense. And I got some candles. Well, he said, get rid of all this mess, and you're not going to be part of the spirits anymore. I'm sure of that. But I did exactly what he told me. Stopped completely. See? Now, today, I'm a blessing to somebody else. A lady wrote me from California. She said, it's very urgent that I get your phone number because I have to talk to you. I cannot write, you know. She said, I couldn't tell you everything in writing. I need to talk to you so greatly because of the fact that I have, I'm being spirit oppressed, demon spirit oppressed. Well, I got the letter, and immediately, oh, she told me, yes, she gave me her phone number. And she said, if you could call me, I'll call you right back. And because she has an answering machine, she's a widow. So she doesn't answer the phone. She always let the machine answer, you know, first before she called anybody back. So I called her up, and she told me what she was up against. She said, you've got to help me. Like she says, you've got to help me. You know what I mean? It was, she said, nobody else can.
It wasn't a question, it was a plea.
Yeah. She said, you've got to help me, Brother Marno. The ministers can't help me over here. And even the president of our conference think I'm crazy. Isn't that sad? Well, I said, exactly what's the problem? And she told me. I'm reading my Bible. And she said, the spirit picked up the Bible and threw it against the wall, like across the room. And when I read your book, I said, this is it. That's the same thing. She told me about being bounced up on her bed, 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, from the ceiling down to the bed, thrown on the bed, and how things move around the house, and she hears a man's voice downstairs, down there, there's nobody. And then she said, the door's open and shut. I go back and check things, everything is locked. The window's open by themselves and shut.
So what did you tell her?
I told her, lady, I said, you're being demon spirit oppressed. What can we do about it? The ministers, my minister says, won't even talk to me anymore about anything. He says, hi, sister, how have you been today? And he tries to talk to somebody else as soon as possible so that I don't have to tell him that in the past week I had some problems. Well, I said, lady, with God's blessing, you got your problem solved. And I gave her the recipe.
And what's the recipe?
I said, now you're going to have to do something very special, okay? I'll do anything that you tell me to do that is in accordance with the will of the Lord. I said, you're going to have to acquaint yourself with the power of the blood of Christ, the redeeming power of the blood of Christ, and what he can do for you that you can do for yourself. Besides saving you for eternity, he can redeem you from this oppression. First, I said, before we go into this, tell me, have you ever had anybody in the last few years, because she said it came back, it started a few years back, about 10 years ago, and every 2 or 3 years she had this kind of an experience, but it didn't last very long. So I told her, what you have, sister, you have a taint of demon spirit defilement. Demon spirits have got direct access to you, and the Lord cannot really help you there, because you have in your home something that belongs to someone that is involved with the spirits of the dead, the supposed spirits of the dead, which are really demon spirits. As anyone that you know that could be involved with the spirits of the dead, she said, yes, the blind lady that I've been taking care of for the last 2 years, three days per week. She's given me a scarf, she's given me a Bible, she's given me different other things. She said, do you think that that could be the thing? After she told me the experience with the old lady, the blind lady, that was it. She didn't want that Bible because the Bible is giving her trouble now. She prays to her mother, and she conversed with her mother. You see, the dead mother.
The blind lady.
The blind lady. And she said, that Bible is giving me trouble. She says, would you like a Bible? So the lady says, well, I have that one already. She says, I'm going to give it to somebody. Why don't you take it? So she had taken the Bible. When she brought the Bible home, that was the beginning of the whole thing. Now the spirits were really moving in. And then she gave her a scarf and gave her other things like that. I said, now...
So you told her to get rid of that
stuff.
That's
right. Now it's 10 o'clock at night. Because she called me back because she was not home. She'd gone to visit her sister 30 miles away, and she came back. And we're talking now, 10 o'clock at night. I said, you want some peace tonight? She says, yes. Take everything, put it in the garage. Then sit yourself down with your Bible and read Matthew, the 27th chapter, the crucifixion of Christ, very attentively and prayerfully and respectfully. You're going to read those 30 verses from verse 24 through 54. And I said, then you talk to the Lord about it, and your problems are over. And sure enough, she called me back the next day. It was on a Saturday night. She called me first. Called back, no problem at all. No noise, nothing. It's gone. It has not returned. Except once. She phoned me up. She says, there's a problem. Yes? Yes, I hear the walking again. All you do. Have you given away everything I told you that you had gotten from this person? Yeah. But she says, I've been thinking about this. There's a man, she says, that dated me, you know, her husband died, right? And a couple of years later, somebody introduced her to this man. And they went out for a few months together, and she decided that he would never become an Adventist because of the fact that he believed in the spirits of the dead so much, you know, and especially of his cousin. They talk about his cousin all the time. And he had given her a lawnmower. I said, you got a lawnmower in the place? He says, yeah. Get rid of the lawnmower. Take the lawnmower and put it outside of your garage. Don't have it on your property. She called me back. She said, everything's fine.
You mean to tell me now, Roger, that if someone who is a spiritist mm-hmm. or is involved in any form of spiritualism
yep.
gives something to someone mm-hmm. that they have in their home, mm-hmm. that gives the spirits the right?
An avenue, open avenue. Now, a lot of people are afraid that people are going to put an X on them, because if they take a piece of your hair or something that belongs to you, you put an X on you, that's paloney. The Lord takes care of all this nonsense. But when a spiritist or somebody that's involved with demon spirits in some form or other gives you anything and you bring it to your home, the spirits have got access to your home openly at all time, and the Lord cannot help you. I'm sorry to see it.
He cannot help you until you voluntarily remove those things.
That is correct. Yeah.
But that does not mean that he doesn't hold them in check, because they would love to destroy.
Destroy them, yeah. I've come across a lot of people that have been writing to me, and they said they've had demon spirits cast out of them by one of those deliverance ministries. And I have one lady that it's been 10 years now since she had demon spirits casted out of them. Out of her, it took 13 hours of praying and talking with the spirits to get the spirits out of her. She said it was like a couple of hundred spirits, you see, in her and all that. And this person's faith has been destroyed completely. Completely destroyed. Now, there are two different, I want to bring this to your attention, there are two different types of people who exorcise demons.
You mean exercise? That's
exorcise,
yeah. Casting demons
casting
out?
Casting demon spirits out of people.
Okay.
You have that in the African religions. And then you have it in Christianity today, where people say, if you are fearful of this and fearful of that, you have a demon of fear in you. So what we're going to have to do, we're going to have to cast out a demon for you. And when these people listen to a sermon from one of these people, these pastors...
And there are actually preachers involved in these deliverance
ministries.
Oh, yes,
definitely. That's what's so sad about it. What happens is they put on a sermon in a church talking about the fact that many of you are undoubtedly demon-possessed. You don't know it.
Is it possible to be possessed by a demon and not know it?
Well, no. Not if you're a Christian. If you are yielding your life to Christ every day, day after day after day, you don't have to worry about demon spirits getting into your life. See? Now what happened is this. The speaker talks about the fact that he has delivered people from demon spirits. There was 100 spirits that came out. It took 10 hours of praying and of wrestling with the spirits to get them out of there. Now, by the time he's done with his sermon, a lot of the people that have different problems. For instance, one preacher says, if you have this certain type of allergy, this certain allergy, you're demon possessed. Well, this poor sister says, she believed that she was demon-possessed. And she said, now, if Jesus could not keep me from being demon-possessed, what kind of a God is he? In the back of her mind, she thinks about it.
So in reality, what you're saying is that these supposed deliverance ministries mm-hmm. that are dealing directly with the occult and casting demons out of people
are not
dangerous.
Yeah, and dangerous. In Matthew, the 7th chapter, the Lord says, many shall say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? In your name have cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works or miracles. And I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. And this is a strong message that he's giving to somebody, some preacher. Well, it's a tremendous destruction of Christianity that these ministries are doing. They're doing a great disservice to Christ.
What specifically is the problem with a deliverance ministry?
A person that is involved in this type of ministry, where they communicate with the spirits,
They talk with the spirits and ask them their names.
Yeah, yeah. They have lost thought completely on Christ. The blood of the atonement has washed away from them. They think they're doing the work of Christ, and they're doing the work of the devil. Because they're tearing people's faith down in Christ. There's one lady that's been calling me every week now, every year, Friday night, and she's a commitment-giving person, or on Sunday, calls me, for a year and a half, as soon as my book on prayer came out. She's had demons cast out of her and all that. That person's fate is so low that I wonder how she's able to keep alive. Keep believing in Christ. She called me here at 11:30 at night, Christmas Eve, last Christmas. I answered the phone. She said, Brother Morno, I got to talk to you. I'm sorry to have called you so late. And she cries. And I said, lady, what is the problem? And she finally was able to stop crying. And then she told me, I was just washing the dishes a while ago, and a man's hand was placed on my left shoulder. I quickly turned around, there's nobody there. So she says, the same spirit that has been trying to take the wheels off my car and driving down the road. See, she had that experience also, the wheels were coming loose. She pulled in the service station, she says, something wrong with my car. The guy says, well, yes, you look at that, the nuts have gone on your front wheel. So he tightens the nut, she gets back in the car, tightens the nuts, I should say, there's five of them. Drive down another mile, and the same thing happens to do the same on the back. She stopped at a service station, and the guy says, yeah, look, he says, the nuts are coming off the wheel.
And this is a lady who had
all these
hundreds of devils cast out of her 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So she said, what am I going to do? I said, you're going to do what you need to do. Fortify yourself in the merits of the blood of Christ. And then I have to rebuild her confidence in the power of the Creator. See? Talk to her about Colossians. About the creative power of Christ. That we are complete in Him, which is the head of all principality and powers. See? He's created them all. So anyway, that this lady, she told me, she said, would you mind if I call you every week? Because it seems that when I talk with you, I regain faith in the merits of God of Christ, enough to be able to sustain myself for a week. But then she says, if I don't call you, by the middle of the week, she says, I'm ready, she says, to die. You know? She's a person of responsibility. I won't say where she works. She works for the federal government. And she's in a high position, highly paid person, superly educated and a beautiful person, you know, and beautiful intellect. But the person, she says, I'll never recover from this thing. I said, yes, sister, you will recover from this. Don't you worry.
What did you recommend to her?
Well, it would be quite lengthy to go into it because she has such a bad case of everything. See?
But you just have a few of these really hardcore cases that you work with very carefully.
Mm-hmm.
But some of them are wrecks after having gone through these deliverance ministries. That's the important thing.
Yeah. Because once they've been told by a preacher, if they were told by the grocery manager down the supermarket that they were demon-possessed because they have such an affliction, it wouldn't destroy the faith in Christ. But when a man that says, I'm a minister of the gospel, stands in that pulpit, and he says, if you have these certain fears or whatever it is, you are undoubtedly possessed by a demon. Now, the first thing that hits the mind is that, what kind of a savior do I have that couldn't keep me from becoming demon-possessed? The power of suggestion, we are told, is the greatest force on earth known to man. Mm-hmm. Alexander the Great, that conquered the world, he used the power of suggestion. He didn't want to use his armies. He said, I used the armies as the last resort. I used the power of suggestion, he says. So they would tend themselves around the city, and they would have speakers that would go and speak every morning and evening to the people that were in the city, telling them to give up. You're not going to come out of this alive. And by tearing down the mind to the fact, to the possibility that they will survive, then negative thoughts come in, and the people said, let's give in. He's going to have us anyway. And history tells us that he won the world not by the sword, but by the words that he spake, or that his people speak for him. So the power of suggestion is the greatest force on earth known to man that's been established by knowledgeable people. And when a minister of the gospel stands up in the pulpit and he says to the people that even though you're a Christian, you can be demon possessed. And you undoubtedly are. He destroys faith in the merits of the blood of Christ completely. When that faith goes down to a zero figure, you know what can take place then? Demon spirits can come right in, an avenue to the soul, man. And they camp home and they said, we got it. So the preacher says, now at 7 o'clock tonight, we're going to meet here and have a service. Get these demons out. Get yourself prepared to maybe stay all night and pray all night for these demons. You see, one person, there's a number of people that called me and told me about these things. And people that have, like mothers that have had daughters that had, you know what I mean? Demons and all that possessing them. Sad to see. A lot of them killed themselves. And the preacher will get there and they're going to start praying over this person, demon possessed, and talk with the demon and find out the name of the demon and find out where the demon has been doing for centuries. And they get all kinds of really interesting insights on the supernatural. The spirits love it. And they come out when they feel like it. What's in their interest to keep right on talking with the preacher and say, I'm not going to go out. You know? And then another voice comes out and says, well, I'm Christine, you know, and another personality of hers and another demon and all that. And,
it's all demon games is what you're
demon
saying.
Demon games, yeah. And by the time that the spirits are all out, the person is almost dead.
Roger, there have been several people who have contacted you with special problems. And you have developed a 7-point plan to help someone who is either has messed with the occult or is involved in the occult or is being harassed. Would you share with us just the high points of that 7-point plan?
Sure. I've had a number of people that have written me or phoned and were highly distressed because of the fact that, you know, they were harassed by demon spirits and they couldn't understand why. Now, on page 534 of the Great Controversy, there is a two-line statement here that I'd like to bring your attention. Satan is seeking to overcome men today as he overcame our first parents by shaking their confidence in their Creator. Interesting, isn't it? Now, as I mentioned before, earlier, once a religious leader stands in the pulpit and convinces people that they are demon-possessed, and their faith goes down to a zero figure, demon spirits move in then, for real. And they exorcise these people, and these spirits, I should say, and etc. But then I came up with a plan that people can really get some help and get it quick. Now here is a 7-step recovery program for those who are oppressed by demon spirit and who have been victimized through so-called deliverance ministries. They're not really deliverance, they involve you more in that which is destroying your Christian experience or will separate you from God. Point number one, throw out or destroy all literature that one has on deliverance ministries. Get rid of everything that they've given you. Demon spirits have a right to stay with all objects that bear the taint of their defilement.
So it's not just items that relate to the occult they should get rid of, which they should get rid of, but also anything that has to do with the deliverance ministry.
That's right.
Okay.
Do not speak to demon spirits, even if it is to command them to depart in the name of the Lord Jesus. Like I have done it before I was knowledgeable with the Word of God.
Let me just understand that. That if a person is confronted, they should not even command a demon spirit to leave in the name of Jesus Christ, not even talk to them. What should they do?
When let me bring something to your attention. When Jesus, a number of times in the Bible, we read that Jesus casted out demon spirits out of people. In this one instance, for instance, the spirits wanted to decide to talk, that he was a son of God. And Jesus forbid them to talk, because they are lying spirits. They'll say 3 or 4 words of truth and 10 of lies. And you put it all together and people feel, you know, he's talking about the Lord Jesus so nicely, it's got to be of the Lord, you see. And it's not so in the world of spiritual conflict.
If a person is in a situation where demonic power is evident, they are not to even command that spirit to leave in the name of Jesus Christ. How are they to get rid of them? Do they kneel down and pray?
No.
Do they let the Holy Spirit do it?
Yes.
What do they do?
You do it by the power of the Spirit of God. Now, Jesus told the Jews that he casted out demons through the power of the Holy Spirit. He informed them on that. And the Apostle Paul, we read in the 19th chapter of the book of Acts, went to Ephesus, and Ephesus was a cult area of all kinds of occultism, of demon spirit involvement. It was a great center of occultism in the Roman Empire. And there he remained there for 2 years, and with 12 of his followers that he met there, they prayed for these Ephesians. They were pagans. They were, you know, there was no Christians living there at all. And we are told that he did a tremendous work, or I should say better than that, the Holy Spirit did a tremendous work as a result of their prayers. And the Spirit of God rested upon Paul so much that people would even come to him and with handkerchiefs and with aprons, it says. And the Bible says, and I quote verses 11 and 12, says, "And God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs and aprons. And the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits left them." Or, you know. So the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, is what does the cleansing and the getting rid of demons. You don't even have to mention get out in the name of Jesus. And that is it's a fallacy. I'll tell you why. It's dangerous. That's what it is. Because the spirits will reply to you most of the time. And you get involved with them, and you're a loser, because you become tainted.
So immediately then, if you are confronted with a demonic power, the thing you would do is pray and ask the power of the Holy Spirit to remove that demonic force. That's the correct procedure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I've dealt with people that were demon-possessed, no question about it, in my business of the Yellow Page advertising. Certain persons that nobody wanted to hang into the account. This guy is weird. One guy says, "I think he's demon-possessed. He was a Baptist." So I think this guy's demon possessed. I want to never handle this account again. Yeah. I go in there, and the guy's is blaspheming and hitting the desk with his fist, and he's talking to somebody over the phone, telling them to go somewhere in a real big hurry. And I just start praying for the Holy Spirit of God, through the ministry of the blood of Christ shed on Calvary, to do the work which Jesus said he would do. And by asking for the blood of Christ to be appropriated to this man, see, and that his sins be forgiven him. He probably hasn't confessed his sins in 20 years. He has no desire to. But he's entitled to the freedom and the deliverance that Christ gives to us through his shedding of his precious blood. And I've seen people just like a big balloon that you put a pin into. Whew. The pressure is gone. The guy smiles. Hasn't smiled in a month. You know? One guy says, hey, man, he says, you know something? You've been here 10 minutes, and it's the only 10 minutes I've had of rest in the last week. He says, what are you anyway? You know? He says, you've got a special power with you, man.
Did you tell him it was the Spirit of God with you?
I didn't tell him right there and then, but I did a little later.
You mentioned 2 points. What's your third point? Go ahead and review the first
okay.
two. The first
you throw one, away all literature and all matter of materials that has been related to these either deliverance ministries, or if you're involved with occultism in some form or other. Don't speak to the spirits. Ignore them completely. And you just ask for the Lord, by the power of his Holy Spirit, in the merits of the blood of Christ, to drive away the spirits. Now you say, where do you get this thing? Well, I have a lot of verses from the Bible that I could prove it to you from. But I want to read you a quotation from page 431 of The Desire of Ages, because it puts it real the way I like to have it. Earnest, persevering supplications to God in faith can alone avail to bring men the Holy Spirit's aid in the battle against principalities and powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, and wicked spirits in high places. And I've proven this for 45 years. This is not new to me. This is what I've experienced over the years.
Excellent.
Yeah. Now, part three is early in the morning, read about the crucifixion of Christ. It takes 4 minutes without having to rush through it. Matthew 27 chapter, read verses 24 through 54. It'll take you from Pilate's judgment hall and bring you to Golgotha. And there you will see the Son of God expire on the cross. And the earthquake took place. And even the Roman pagan says, truly, this was the Son of God. See?
And as you read that, you visualize it, and you're actually there each morning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
And it'll change your life. One man phoned me up. He says, I've been going to Golgotha every morning now. He says, from Pilate's Judgment Hall to Golgotha every morning, like you told me last year. My life has changed. I'm not the same person.
Praise the Lord.
He says, I got a different view and understanding of the conflict between the force of good and evil. I understand more exactly what Jesus did for me. And he couldn't stop telling what it had done for his life. Now, you must ask God, even if it's in the middle of the afternoon, you pray 10 times before that, okay? You're going to pray about someone, or in a case like this, say, Lord, before I ask you for your help, I want you to make sure that if I have offended you in thoughts, words, and deeds, that you remove the offenses by the merits of the blood of Christ. I always make sure that I have a clean slate. Because the Bible tells us that the human heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And there's a lot of wickedness that can pass in our thoughts, man. Even if we don't stop ourselves to look at it, you know. And you have to pray for faith and for the power of Christ to save you. Now, we're told by the pen of inspiration that faith is inspired by the Holy Spirit. And it flourishes only as it is cherished. I will talk to you only right now about the first part. It's inspired by the Holy Spirit. So if we need the faith, where do we go? We go to Christ or to the Father, and we plead for this very special blessing. And it'll always be given you. Blessings that are marvelous. Point seven is to memorize the Word of God in order to live a victorious, successful Christian life. And to memorize the Word of God, it automatically brings you faith, hope, joy in the Lord. And that is power.
Roger, On the last book that you wrote on intercessory prayer, did you experience any harassment at that time?
Yes, some.
So the demon spirits from 45 years ago still didn't want you talking.
That's right. As I started to write the manuscript, I wasn't very gone into it more than maybe, well, I'd written the first chapter of it just for the kids to have something to read after, if I pass away, they'll have something to know how the old man was able to pray, and the Lord blessed, you know, my experience in the hospital in Canada. But then, after Daniel had told me, Dad, you should write a book, and I said, no, I'm no writer when it comes to prayer. There's been so many books written on prayer. So he said, why don't you just write Mr. Richard Coffin, that helped you with your first book, and Review and Herald, see what he says about it. But Mr. Coffin wrote back and says, yes, send us the 11-page manuscript that you have. We want to look at it. And then, of course, the good news came that they wanted me to submit two more chapters, and then the entire manuscript. Well, as soon as I started the second chapter, it was during the daytime, the garage door started to open. Now, this is an old garage door. This house, by the way, is 100 years old, a little over 100 years old. The part next to it is new, fairly new. But that garage door is probably 40 years old, and it's one of those rollers up and down with the big springs, and it makes a terrible noise when you raise it and when you lower it, and especially when you get to be, when you bring it down, it's about a foot from the floor. If you happen to let go of the handle, it hits that concrete, and the glass panes, the panes of glass rattle, and, you know, makes a lot of noise. And it opened two or three times. I paid no attention to that. Hilda calls me from upstairs, says, come down here and see who's playing at the garage door. I said, I come down. I said, everything's all right. She says, you just sit here and you watch and see. She says, this door has been opening three times, she says, in the last half hour. Oh. And she said, didn't Greg mow the lawn yesterday? I told him, I said, maybe Greg can get the lawnmower or something. He's going to do the lawn. No, he did it yesterday, she said. Well, I got thinking right away. I can't believe it. See, I thought of the spirits right away. But I said, don't worry about it. It's nothing at all. Sure enough, I was going up the staircase. I hear the thing rolling up and then rolling down. So I said, I'm going to go out there. I went out there, and there was nobody around at all. So I came back in to the Hilda. It's not going to happen again. She says, what do you mean it's not going to happen again? How do you know? I said, I don't know. There's a lot of teenagers around here. They must have opened the door and run. You see? But I knew exactly what had taken place. Because that evening, when she worked night shift at the hospital, I started to write again. When I started to write, the door started to roll up and down. Every 20 minutes, 25, 30 minutes, the door would roll up and down. And it would hit concrete, man, and make an awful noise.
So what went through your mind?
Well, I prayed about it. I said, Lord, the spirits don't want me to write this book. But I'm not working for the spirits, I'm working for you. Okay? And I said, if you want me to tell my prayer experience, my prayer life for the last 45 years, you're going to have to help me get rid of those spirits. But it turned out that all that night, that door must have opened 50 times. Because I wrote until 3:30 or 4 o'clock in the morning. So I realized I was not going to be able to write during the daytime. And the next night, same exact same thing. And it went every night that I wrote that manuscript. And I tell you what, I told the Lord, the next night he did it again. I said, Lord, it's okay. You know, this is not heaven on earth. We're in the land of the enemy. So I can't put up with that, you know, as long as my wife is not scared to death. And that's what happened. I wrote the manuscript like this.
And as soon as you finished the manuscript, it stopped.
It stopped, yeah.
But you know, I can understand why the devil is so angry. You are giving a snapshot of a side of his work that very few people have ever had an opportunity to see and live to tell about. And Ellen White tells us that there is nothing that the devil fears more, Roger, than that his methods and his devices will be discovered and people will have a natural defense against them. So I can understand exactly why he was upset, but praise the Lord, the Lord's power was stronger and continues to be stronger.
And the Lord has been gracious to me over the years. I've been in some situations on the road with trucks and storms and snow and sleet and things. I was traveling so much. I was traveling anywhere between 25 to 35,000 miles a year. And that's a lot of miles to put on the road all the time. And I've seen so many instances where I could have been killed, man. Well, as a matter of fact, in my book on prayer, I talk about two or three incidents there.
Well, it occurs to me that there's an old rule that says if you play with fire, you're going to get burned.
Yep.
And fortunately for you, 45 years ago, you were rescued, kind of a brand from the burning.
That's right.
Roger, and your testimony lives on.
Yep.
You've walked into the shadow of death for 45 years, according to the priest, but if I read correctly in your book, you said you wouldn't mind that as long as the Creator walked with you. And
That's
he
right.
has,
yeah.
hasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Okay, I want to show you another thing here, a problem that I have with the Roman Catholic Church with some of their doctrine. I'm going to start out here in Genesis chapter 3 in the King James Bible, of course. And we're going to look at verse 5. Here's the account of Satan tempting Eve in the Garden of Eden. And it says, "For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." Now, the foundation for every false religion out there is this right here. Satan has used the same thing to deceive people for 6,000 years. Ye shall be as gods. He promises them godhood. Okay, now, let me turn over to why would Satan promise them that? Well, that's probably because that's what he tried to get, and he blew it. And it didn't work out. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." He wanted to be God. Okay, that's why he lost his position as the anointed cherub. Satan was a cherub before he got kicked out of heaven. Now here we are in Ezekiel 28. And we will come down here. Let's see, where's the verse that I want? Verse 9. "Wilt thou yet say before him that slayeth thee, I am God? But thou shalt be a man and no God in the hand of him that slayeth thee." Okay, Satan was trying to say that he was God, capital G. I will be like the Most High. Now, a lot of the new versions actually will say a lowercase g God. Satan didn't try to be a lowercase g God because he is one of those. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 says that he is the God of this world. Okay, lowercase g. Satan is a lowercase g God. This is the right reading here. Capital G. Satan wanted to be God Almighty. Now I want to take a look. I want to show you something here, which I think a lot of Catholics are not aware of, that their catechism teaches this. Put my King James Bible right there. Here I have a catechism of the Catholic Church. Let me zoom in a little bit here so you can get a good look at the text. Okay, page 116, and it says, "For the Son of God became man so that we might become God." Capital G. Do you think the Holy Spirit inspired that, or Satan? Isn't that what Satan got kicked out of heaven for? "The only begotten Son of God, wanting to make us sharers in his divinity, assumed our nature so that he, made man, might make men gods." Now, don't tell me that the Holy Spirit inspired this thing. You know, they say that the word of the Pope is infallible and whatever. Well, I guarantee you that is not infallible. That's of the devil right there. God does not want to make us gods, or we might become God, capital G. You know, this is bad enough, but that's even worse. And just in case you're skeptical, and, well, I don't know if that is a recognized Catholic publication, there you have your seal of approval, essentially, at the top, by Pope, he's now Pope Benedict the 16th, I guess. Cardinal Ratzinger. So, there you have it. But in case you're not convinced, I have this one here. This is a 2001 edition. This is my newest one that I have. Let me show you in here very quickly. Zoom in here a little bit so you can see it. The Son of Man became man so that we might become God. The only begotten Son of God, wanting to make us shares in his divinity, assumed our nature so that he made man might make men gods. Again, says the exact same thing as the older edition of the Catechism there. And again, you have Cardinal Ratzinger, Joseph Ratzinger, showing up here. This is certainly a accepted Roman Catholic catechism. Now I want to show you something else. Another problem that I have right there is obviously a satanic problem that the catechism has. That's obviously not of the Lord. The Lord would not say that he wants you to become a god. That's how Satan deceived Eve back in the Garden of Eden. But I want to show you another thing that Jesus Christ warns about in Matthew chapter 24. We'll look here. Okay. And as he sat, verse 3, and as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you. Warning. That's a warning. Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Watch out for somebody coming to you and telling you that they are Christ. Okay? What does the Catechism teach on this subject? Well, let's go to page 228, as you can see there. Let us rejoice then and give thanks that we have become not only Christians, but Christ himself. Do you understand and grasp, brethren, God's grace toward us? Marvel and rejoice, we have become Christ. Wow. So there you have that. Then you have here on page 732, we can adore the Father because he has caused us to be reborn to his life by adopting us as his children in his only Son by baptism. That's a lie. It's not by baptism. It's by the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed once on Calvary. He incorporates us into the body of his Christ through the anointing of his Spirit, who flows from the head to the members. He makes us other Christs. So then you have become sharers in Christ, are appropriately called Christs. No, you're not. You are a Christian. Okay, if you get saved, if you have been born again, put your faith in Jesus Christ, not of works, lest any man should boast, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, read that, okay? If you have done that, then you are a Christian, you are not Christ, and you need to watch out for people coming and saying that they are Christ. But it gets worse than that. Here we have the New St. Joseph Baltimore Catechism. And this thing here is just incredible. Zoom in here a little bit. The Holy Mass. The ordained priest takes the place of Christ. Isn't that something? Okay? I thought the Bible says that there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Oh no, you have to go through an ordained priest. Sure you do. Christ, our high priest in heaven, the priest on earth, another Christ. What we see, what we should think of. Okay. Well, explain that to me, by the way, too. I thought that the host, the communion host here, and the wafer and the thing... So how can it be in the communion host and yet it's there too? See, it's kind of warped. But I wonder what the Catholic children that have been molested by the priests, I wonder if they believe that they were being molested by Christ and tell me that that's of the Lord. That is the epitome of Satanism. Okay, to teach that a man is Christ, a man is Jesus Christ. Many will come in my name saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Pretty wicked. Alright, I want to make a follow-up video here to show the scenes that were cut out of the last video. It was a technical problem here. I don't know whether my camera or the computer didn't render it properly. I'm not sure. But I want to start out here quickly in Matthew chapter 24 to show the verse. 24 verse 5, Jesus speaking here, he says to his disciples, "For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many." People are going to come and say, you know, not only in Jesus' name saying that they are Christians, but they will even go so far as to say that they are Christ. I am Christ. And it says, they shall deceive many. Okay? Take heed that no man deceive you. Now, that's very important. And I want to show here the New St. Joseph Baltimore Catechism. Let me zoom in here. Back on page 259. Zoom in a little bit more. And you see it says, the ordained priest takes the place of Christ. Okay? They shall come in my name saying, I am Christ. And again, on page 213, Christ our high priest in heaven, the priest on earth, another Christ. Okay, watch the other video and you'll see that this is in line with the other two catechisms, the 2001 and then the older one that I show in the other video. It's kind of sad, really, that they would believe this way. And here we have, again, what we see, what we should think of. So you have the priest there, and you should actually be seeing that he is Christ, which is kind of weird because with the whole transubstantiation thing and the Eucharist and all this and the communion host, according to Catholic doctrine, Christ is actually here in the bread and the wine, the cup there. He's here, but he's also here. Yeah. Doesn't make much sense. Let me show you another one here. New St. Joseph First Communion Catechism. This is one for children. And here on page 53, the Mass is Christ's act of love. So again, you see, you don't even see a picture of a priest there. You see a picture of, you know, a depiction of Christ, of Jesus Christ. And he is the priest. Now, a lot of these kids, you know, not in this drawing obviously, but there are children, many, many thousands of children that have been molested by their priest. And, you know, if you're a Catholic, you have to admit to that. I mean, yeah, it's been in the news. Now, a Catholic child, they're taught that their priest is Christ. So in their little minds, if they're a devout Catholic, they're thinking Christ molested them. You see? Pretty evil. And here you have, I'll just show you another one real quick. The priest takes Christ's place. Now let me just show you why I have a problem with that. We're going to go to the book of 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. Let me zoom in here so you can read it. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. Jesus Christ is the one mediator between God and man, not a Catholic priest. All right, and the reason I'm doing these videos, by the way, I'm not trying to attack Catholics and hate Catholics as people. It's the system. It's the religious system of Catholicism that I'm opposed to. And there's all this talk about the ecumenical movement and, you know, we need to respect other faiths and there are many paths to God. But when you actually study Roman Catholicism, you'll see that their beliefs do not teach that. Here you have this picture, heaven, Mary helping people up the ladder to heaven. And it says, how does Jesus help all men to gain heaven? Jesus helps all men to gain heaven through the Catholic Church. The Church is like a ladder to heaven. Jesus gave us only one ladder. The Church is our only way to heaven. How does the Catholic Church help us to gain heaven? The Catholic Church helps us to gain heaven, especially through the sacraments. There you have your different sacraments, the ladder there, the magic ladder that goes to heaven. The Church is our ladder to heaven, and it goes on and on. Let's look at some more things from the Baltimore Catechism. Here you have a Catholic sins against faith by taking part in non-Catholic worship when he intends to identify himself with a religion he knows is defective. Now, I'm not a Catholic. I'm a born-again, Bible-believing Christian. And according to this, my religion is defective. My relationship with Jesus Christ is defective because I'm not a Catholic. Here you have a Catholic sins against faith by all those things there, and also taking part in non-Catholic worship. A Catholic can best safeguard his faith by refusing to associate with the enemies of the Church and by not reading books, kind of like the King James Bible, which the Catholic Church has never endorsed, and papers opposed to the Church and her teaching. Are all obliged to belong to the Catholic Church in order to be saved? All are obliged to belong to the Catholic Church in order to be saved. When we say outside the Church there is no salvation, we mean that Christ made the Catholic Church a necessary means of salvation and commanded all to enter it so that a person must be connected with the Church in some way to be saved. No one can be saved except by being united to the Catholic Church. Interesting. Where's the word Catholic at in the Bible? It's not there. That's not, Jesus Christ did not found the Catholic Church. That's nonsense. Here you have the Church. Which is the one true church established by Christ? The one true church established by Christ is the Catholic Church. Again, where's it at in the Bible? Where's the word sacrament in the Bible? Where's the word nun? Where's the word monk? Where's the word pope? You know? Now, I just want to show you one other thing here. I'm going to do more of a review on this at some other time. Just to, again, another witness against this whole ecumenical thing. The Church teaches documents of the Church in English translation by Jesuit fathers of St. Mary's College. And I want to show you a verse, one of the most important two verses in the entire New Testament, speaking of salvation, what you must do to be saved. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. Now, if you're a Bible believer, you know these verses probably by heart. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Not of sacraments, not of belonging to the Catholic Church, or the Baptist Church, or the Presbyterian Church, or the Lutheran, or the Methodist, or whatever. Being part of a denomination doesn't make you saved, okay? The Catholic Church is not a necessary means of salvation. It's not of works. It's through faith, by faith in Jesus Christ. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. It's by faith, okay? But let me show you here on this, in this, the Church teaches, official documents written by the Jesuits. Here you have page 263. Let me back it out here a little bit so you can read the whole thing. If anyone says that the sacraments of the new law are not necessary for salvation, but that they are superfluous, and that men can without the sacraments or the desire of them obtain the grace of justification by faith alone, although it is true that not all the sacraments are necessary for each individual, let him be anathema. Damned to hell is what that means. This book, I don't know the exact number, I haven't counted it yet, but this book has probably a couple of hundred curses in it. Let him be anathema. If you believe this, let him be anathema. 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 Damning people to hell that are not part of the Catholic Church. So don't fall for all this ecumenical, oh, there are many paths to God and whatever. No, the Catholic Church is the most narrow-minded church out there. Faith in Jesus Christ alone, his finished work on the cross, is what will get you saved. All right, I want to talk for a minute about this sickening article that was in our local newspaper. I'm sure a lot of you out there have already heard of this, but I want to just point out a couple points on this thing. So let me show you about this. All right, here we have the Faith and Values section of our local newspaper. This is Saturday, March 26th of 2011. And over here, we have the Jesuits settle in sex case. Now, why is this in the Faith and Values section? Here's a story about a couple who lost their son years ago. He was martyred. And over here you have the guy writing about the Westboro wackos, which they shouldn't even be giving them people press, you know, whatever. Just ignore them, they'll go away. But why is this in the Faith and Values section? Okay, that's kind of weird. But I want to show you something here, which we're not going to go over the article. You can look it up online. But I just want to show you something here, just to show you that there are different rules for Catholics than there are for Christians. And yeah, I said that right. Catholics are not Christians. Attorney Blaine Tamaki said the priest who molested Vargas and about 100 other children, 100 children this pervert molested, has not been charged with a crime because the statute of limitations in Washington state is so restrictive. Molested 100 children, and he was not charged with a crime. That's the power that the Jesuit order has. And it's interesting, they keep referring to the order, the order, the order, the order in there. Here's an article from CNN Belief Blog. Okay, Jesuits pay record $166.1 million in child abuse case. Let me zoom in here. It says 470 people were sexually and psychologically abused as children by Jesuit priests from the 1940s to the 1990s. 470 people. But you say, why aren't these people talking? Well, I'm going to tell about that later. But jump down here a little bit in the article. It says, Jesuits are the largest order of Catholic priests and are considered the most educated in the priesthood as they run prestigious universities. And that's not just Catholic universities. They infiltrate Protestant, quote-unquote, Protestant universities as well. Most of the abuse occurred in the 1960s, so many of the alleged victims are now in their late 40s and early 50s, Tamaki said. And again, I'm going to talk about why are these people not talking. I'm going to say about that in just a little bit. Look at this. None of the 57 Jesuit priests accused of sexual abuse by the victims have been charged with any crimes. None of the 57 Jesuit priests have been charged. Are there people that are above the law? You better believe it. The Jesuits are. Next page here it says, Lawrence was in third grade when the molestation began, allegedly by a priest and a nun. It's not just the priests that are perverts, it's the nuns as well, who worked with the Jesuit missionaries, according to Tamaki. These are Native American and Alaskans, by the way. And this is the third largest case, I think. There were two other cases where the Catholic Church had to pay out millions and millions of dollars because they're just molesting kids by the millions. Disgusting, sick. Before he died, Lawrence provided a statement for Friday's press conference. The nun or one of the brothers would send me to the rectory to see the priest. He would give me candy or call me special, and then he would molest me. They all did at various times, his statement said. All did. They all did. This isn't an isolated incident either. Lawrence said that he was scared to tell anyone because all of the boys were told repeatedly that men of God don't talk. We were scared that if we uttered even one word, we would go to hell, his statement said. You know, for a while I just thought it was that these priests were just perverts or pedophiles, forced celibacy, that's why they're perverted. I think it's more than that now. I think it's actually satanic ritual abuse. I think these Jesuits and these Catholic priests are purposefully molesting children. Because you see, what does it create? What did the article say? What did it say here on CNN's website? You know, mainstream media. It said that the people were afraid. And it took some of them 40 or 50 years to come out and tell the truth. You see, the Catholic Church is about instilling fear in their people. That's what it's about. It's about, you've committed a mortal sin. You've lost your salvation. You're excommunicated. You're damned to hell. You're anathema. That's the system of Roman Catholicism. It's a system of bondage, of fear. And what better way to scare someone than to molest them as a child? And then to tell them, if you tell anybody about this, you're going to go to hell. And you take them, you put them into the confessional booth. First you get some things on them that you can use so you can blackmail them. And then you take them in and you molest them and you say, if you tell anybody, you're going to go to hell. You know? But it gets even worse than that. I'm going to tell you why I believe it's true satanic ritual abuse. Let's look at a couple of these wicked Catholic catechisms. Now let me show you some of the wicked writings of these satanic devils. Here you have two catechisms basically for children. This one here is, you know, my first communion catechism. You give this to little kids. Okay, and this is the new St. Joseph Baltimore catechism. This one is also designed for children. But let me show you here first what a good Catholic is taught about their priest. The priest takes Christ's place. Isn't that disgusting? And you say, well, that's just one catechism. We don't, you know, the Catholics, oh, we don't believe that. We don't believe that. Yes, you do. The ordained priest takes the place of Christ. There you go. The Holy Mass. Yeah, uh-huh. Come on here. The next bookmark. Christ our high priest in heaven, the priest on earth, another Christ. Interesting, because Jesus Christ warned in Matthew 24 about men coming and saying, I am Christ, and deceiving many. There's your devil worshiper right there. There's your Satanist. These men are just the most foul, most wicked creatures on the planet. What we see, what we should think of. It's not really the priest up there. It's Jesus Christ himself. Isn't that disgusting? And by the way, think of how stupid this whole thing is, really. Because the priest just consecrated the host and the wine there, which is supposed to be the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. And yet, their system is so idiotic that you have, oh, the body and the blood there, but this guy's actually supposed to be Christ. Doesn't even make sense. It's not supposed to, because it's a system built by the father of lies. And look at this. The church always does the will of its divine founder. Oh, really? So, this over here, church always does the will of its divine founder. Is this the will of its divine founder? Paying out $166.1 million to hundreds of Native American and Alaska Natives? Is that the will of its divine founder? How do you reconcile this stuff if you're a Catholic? How do you line this up? Your church is not legitimate. Your church is not Christian. You are part of Satan's church. And by the way, I should add, if you're a Catholic out there and you're protesting, well, we don't recognize those as being authoritative and all this other junk, right here in the front of both of them, it says, Nihil obstat, imprimatur of the archbishop and all this other garbage. This is official Catholic literature right here. Nothing objectionable. So sorry, but you do believe in these things. And by the way, it says here in the front of it that if you pray this prayer here, you'll have an indulgence of 5 years. 5 years less time in purgatory. and if you for teaching or studying Christian doctrine, an indulgence of 3 years. For reading the Bible, an indulgence of 3 years. So you get the same for studying this garbage as you would for reading a Catholic Bible. Just ridiculous. But again, the system of fear. Even if you're a good Catholic, you're going to have to go to purgatory and you're going to have to burn for a while. Why would you be part of this? Well, maybe because you're afraid. You know, this isn't of the Lord. You know, it has nothing to do with the Bible. I mean, the Bible doesn't even teach most of this garbage. It is so disgusting to me to think of men and even women, the nuns there, you saw that in the article, molesting children. They truly are Satanists. Okay, a lot of people have this funny notion that Satanism is Anton LaVey and the Temple of Set, Michael Aquino and the Order of the Trapezoid and all that. That's the flesh, okay? I'm sure that they worship Satan in their own little way and all that stuff. I know about them, whatever. But true Satanism is found in 2 Corinthians 11, I believe it is, where it says that Satan appears as an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers appear as the ministers of righteousness. A true Satanist is in churches. Okay? Right there is your true Satanism. This is far more evil than the Satanic Bible or anything else. Why? Because this kind of stuff appeals to people into the millions. There's over a billion Catholics out there. And why are they staying in a system of child molestation? And, you know, there are full-grown women that are being molested too, and teenage boys and things. Why are they staying in it? Because it's a system of fear. It's a system of bondage. And if you're out there and you're watching this and you're saying, well, I'm a Christian, you know, but I still go to the Catholic Church. You need to get out of that system as quickly as is possible. Leave. Get out. That thing is so filled with devils. Man, you're crazy to go to a Catholic church. I wouldn't be caught dead in one. The Lord is going to be returning soon. The Lord Jesus Christ. And He's going to be pouring out His wrath on this wicked, wicked planet. Okay? This is so vexing to me to think of little children being molested by Catholic priests, and it's been going on for centuries. Very, very disgusting. It just, man, my blood is boiling. And, it's just going to keep going on. Why? It's not, like I said, it's not about a thing of they're just perverts and that's just, you know, kind of a thing, they get tempted there. No, I actually believe it's intentional. I believe that they are intentionally molesting children to bring them into a system of fear. And really, if they're good Catholics, they believe that it wasn't a priest that did it to them. They believe that Jesus Christ molested them. That's what the Catechism teaches. It's not the priest, it's Christ. Get out of that Catholic Church. And these Vatican versions and things that I'm always attacking, people wonder why I attack the Catholic Church so much. Right there's the reason why. Satanic ritual abuse being performed by Jesuit priests and nuns and regular priests too. Just disgusting. The wrath of God is going to be poured out on Mystery Babylon, which I believe the Roman Catholic Church is Mystery Babylon. I have a sermon on that on Sermon Audio if you want to hear more about that. God's wrath is coming to the Catholic Church. He's going to put an end to this disgusting nonsense very, very soon. So, if you see anything Catholic, man, run away from it. Get away from it. Bad stuff.
have ourselves a very little interesting situation here. We got ourselves a new little article about our Pope. According to Malachi, he would be the final Pope, and he would feed the flock. But then again, he also had the prophecy of St. Francis of Assisi, wasn't it? Didn't we discuss that? Where he believed he said he'd be a destroyer. So you got the Pope here, and he's begging forgiveness from the victims of the people that are claiming that they've been sexually abused by different clergy. And you can read through this. He expresses his personal sorrow. He does not tolerate harm done to a minor by any individual, whether a cleric or not, and promised that the bishops would be held accountable. He begs your forgiveness, too, for the sins of omission on the part of the church leaders who did not respond adequately. So he's asking to be forgiven. He's given out his apologies, but as of yet, we do not see any that I found. Tell me if you have any of the accused who supposedly molested parishioners. You don't see him being fired and kicked out of the church, do you? Has he done that? No. Has any of them been charged in a court of law that we know of and prosecuted like a normal individual? Has anybody seen anybody have that done to them? Tell me if you know they have, because I haven't found that. So we got what we got. Is some meaningless words from this man, but no action has taken place. The veil of papal immunity is still umbrellaed over these people, these perverts, and what the crimes they've committed. You don't see any prosecution of them. All you see is him saying, I'm sorry, forgive, please forgive. Nobody's fired, nobody's prosecuted, nobody's punished, nobody's jailed. Now, you go back here 4 or 5 weeks ago, and you see another little interesting article. Remember, I did you a video not too far back on the Black Pope, and I showed you who he was. And in this particular article, there he is, the Jesuit superior, as I told you before, Pachon. I believe it is Nicholas Adolfo Pachon. According to this article, he has announced his resignation, and I'm going to read through this one because it's very interesting if it holds truth to it. It is kind of crazy and out there, but I think it's got some water and it'll hold up. This Black Pope apparently resigned after this International Common Law Court of Justice in Brussels had linked him to the Ninth Circle Satanic Child Sacrifice Cult Ceremonies. You ever heard of them? If you haven't, Google it up. Read all about it. And for about a month, 5 judges examined various evidences, documents, had some eyewitnesses, They link the Black Pope Pachon, even Pope Francis, and our former Pope, Ratzinger, Archbishop of Canterbury, who is Justin Welby, to the ritual rape and killing of children as recently as 2010. And if you, this is reminding you what the Francis made a, they call it bizarre, but he likened sex abuse to a satanic mass. Well, they take it to mean that he reveals he understands that the rape of children within the church is linked to satanic rituals, and they are. I mean, you'll find different Satanists that say, nah, we don't kill kids in our ceremonies and whatnot, but you'll find other Satanists that say they do. Now, another Jesuit order called the Magisterial Privilege goes back to 1967 concerning the Black Mass have been provided to this court from the Vatican archives. And the document was said to show that every new pope was required to participate in the Ninth Circle Satanic Black Mass ritual sacrifice of newborn children, included the drinking of their blood. And Vatican documents clearly indicate that for centuries, Jesuits had a premeditated plan to ritually murder, kidnap newborn babies, and then consume their blood. The prosecutor told the court that this plan was born of a twisted notion to derive spiritual power from the lifeblood of the innocent, thereby assuring political stability of the papacy in Rome. Not only was it genocidal, but systematic and institutionalized in nature since at least 1773, and supposedly performed by the Roman Catholic Church, Jesuits, and every pope. The pope's remarks are the lowest kind of sadistic insensitivity, agreed Ruth Leopold, 51-year-old American who claimed to be a survivor of this Black Mass torture. So you have some witnesses and supposed survivors. Now he has Leopold's Against Church Terror Survivors Network headed a witness delegation to the Brussels court. The 2014 court was prosecuting global elite members, and that would include Francis and the Black Pope, Pachon, and Welby. You have at least 8 eyewitnesses have testified that either Francis or Ratzinger or Pachon were present with them as children at these child sacrifices. And the Black Pope decided to step down, and supposedly, I don't know if that, I didn't hear this, but supposedly Pope Francis suggested to reporters during a recent tour of the Holy Land that he might follow Ratzinger's example and retire, and that would be last in line. Who's going to take over after him? Malachi showed that he would be the last. So, supposedly, on February 15, 2013, the Brussels court found ex-Pope Ratzinger guilty of crimes against humanity, and then he resigned a few days later. Now, the witness's name, other Ninth Circle Satanic Child Sacrifice cult members, as the Dutch Catholic Cardinal Alfrink, Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands, British, Dutch, and Belgian royal family members, including Queen Elizabeth, Prince Philip, Dutch Queen Wilhelmina, her family, and consort King Henrik, Pope Francis, Pope Ratzinger, Archbishop Welby, 2 British High Court judges, including Judge Fulford, Canadian Catholic Bishop and Senior Government Ministers in Belgium and England. Some have been, let's see, it goes on into here. It talks about different children. British citizen David Coffin and his wife were accosted, drugged, arrested, incarcerated in the London Park Royal Mental Health Center for posting Queen Elizabeth's arrest warrant on a Catholic church. They are victims of the global elite Ninth Circle Satanic cult. Jamaican and British soldier Vivian Cunningham remained drugged in St. George Hospital in Stafford, England, just for asking questions about Queen Elizabeth's arrest warrant for kidnapping 10 Native children. Last October, in Canada, Steve Finney was trying to expose this cult. About some 50,000 missing Native children that included Queen Elizabeth's kidnapping charges conviction. And he was arrested and held in prison for 3 days with no charges. That's a very interesting article. Makes you wonder, doesn't it? Could it be? Do you think it holds water? Do you think this cult, Ninth Circle Satanic Child Sacrifice Cult, is real? I think that Malachi Martin mentioned that Satan had entered into the Vatican a long time ago, which means they've been infiltrated, which means evil had wormed its way into this order. And there's a good chance that it ran it. So, there's a lot of good Catholic believers. I'm not bashing this parishioners, not by any means. But I am saying educate yourself. Look at the things that you see when you go in. Look at the idols. Look at the way they're dressed. Ask questions. Ask them, where did this come from? Look back in history. Go way back to the times of the Babylonians. Look at the way they dressed. Look at the mitres they wore. Look at the staffs they carried. Look at the renditions of the pine cone. See the similarities in these things that you see within the Catholic Church. And then try to understand how Constantine merged paganism in with this version of the Catholic Church, because this is not the actual old-time Catholicism. You know what I'm trying to say? This is the new and better version that supposedly was introduced later on that combined paganism and Catholicism and was introduced upon the world. You know, this is not the, Peter, you're the rock that I'll build my church upon, Catholicism. What we see now is it was changed. You need to understand that. You need to try and learn about it. Don't doubt your faith in Jesus, not at all. But don't believe everything you see with your eyes. Ask questions to your pastor. Go over his head. Take some time. Hit the library if you have to. Go find books. You know, look it up online. When things look the same of 4,000 or 5,000 years before this version of Catholicism ever existed, then you can start to understand where they pulled some of the things that they have today from. And the Babylonians were pagans. So the staffs, the pine cones, the mitres, the this, the that, those were things that God didn't like. And that's what I have to say. So, he apologized.
Is the Roman Catholic system guilty of promoting child pornography? I believe the answer to that question is a definite yes. And I believe that they've been doing it for centuries. And I'm not even going to get into the actual child pornography. I'm going to show you a softcore child pornography. And I call it child pornography because it has no basis in scripture. Okay. And I have here the Cornell University Law School's Legal Information Institute, their definition, 18 U.S. Code number 2256, definitions for what constitutes child pornography. I'm going to read some of these definitions here. It says here, for the purposes of this chapter, the term minor means any person under the age of 18 years. And you're going to see in Catholic art that there are definitely nude minors, children under the age of 18. And it goes down through a bunch of things. I'm not going to put this stuff up because it's into some pretty graphic language here. But number three, it says, producing means producing, directing, manufacturing, issuing, publishing, or advertising. And certainly Roman Catholicism has added to this thing of child pornography. And I'm going to show you that here as we continue. Number eight, child pornography means any visual depiction, including any photograph, film, video, picture, or computer-generated image or picture, whether made or produced by electronic, mechanical, or other means of sexually explicit conduct, where the production of such visual depiction involves the use of a minor engaging in sexually explicit conduct. Now, I'm going to show you some of that here in just a minute. And I'm going to put a little bit of modesty, little blacked out areas on the pictures, just because you don't need to be vexed. But if you jump down to number 11, now here's where they will squeak through. The Roman Catholic artists down through the centuries, they'll squeak through with this definition. Definition number 11 says here, this definition does not apply to depictions that are drawings, cartoons, sculptures, or paintings depicting minors or adults. So the Cornell Law School there, the Law Institute, gives an exemption to the Roman Catholic perverts that have been down through the centuries. And you got to watch out for this thing of art too, okay? I was in the art field for a few years, and I know a lot of this stuff, you know, they just push the envelope of what is acceptable and they call it art. Okay, you're painting nude things and stuff all the time, you're a pervert, okay? Don't tell me, oh, it's because I respect the human body, and sure you do. I was around that stuff. I know what, you know, how that thing works. But let me show you some things here. Now, remember it said about computer-generated images and things like this. Well, if you go to Restored Traditions, here's a painting which I saw and I thought, this is rather telling. Okay, you have Saint Anthony of Padua and Christ Child painted by Chambers. All right, now take a look at that picture. Now tell me, is that thing biblically accurate? No. First of all, the quote-unquote Christ Child has blonde hair. And when was the Christ Child ever picked up by a Roman Catholic monk or priest, whatever this guy, this pervert was here, whatever this guy was, when was Jesus Christ as a baby ever picked up by a priest and kissed on the cheek? And see how there's makeup and stuff on the child's face and it's meant to look attractive and kind of like that? Now, you know, to a normal person, they look at that and they just go, oh, it's, you know, a priest holding a child or whatever. But what if you're a pedophile priest, one of these perverts that are into the just thousands upon thousands of these pervert priests? And you had Benedict, you know, Pope Benedict there, the last devil that was in, covering up for the whole pedophile priest scandal. And they're dealing out hundreds of millions of dollars, you know, to cover up their sins of raping small children. And of course, some Catholic out there is going to say, well, the Protestants do it too. Yes, I'm well aware of that. That's why I'm not a Protestant. I'm not a Catholic and I'm not a Protestant. Okay? I'm a Bible-believing Christian. We existed centuries before the Roman Catholics ever even came to be known. All right? Donatists, Paulicians, you know, the Waldensians, the Vaudois, the Albigensians, the Huguenots later on, all those early Christian groups. The Catholics always just called us heretics, you know. I'm still considered as a heretic. Big surprise. But you see there, you know, look at, I mean, tell me, what is that painting all about? And of course, you know, there I'm not going to get into the phallic significance of the tonsure haircut there of that monk. But, you know, this St. Anthony of Padua, by the way, is the patron saint of lost items. Just in case you lose your keys, you can pray to this lunatic devil right here, and he'll help you find your keys. I'm not joking, by the way. He is the patron saint of lost items. He looks more to me like the patron saint of pedophiles, pedophile priests. Let me show you another painting. Here again, you see the naked baby, and Mary is presenting him to the pervert priest. Isn't that so nice? Yeah, that's just so wonderful. You know. And there you have this pervert priest again, you know, and he's holding these white lilies symbolizing purity. Oh, isn't that wonderful? What are you doing with a little naked baby that's not your child? You know? Another one. Again, I mean, look at the lusty, you know, look in this child's eyes is looking into the priest's eyes, and you know, don't tell me some pervert priest isn't going to look at that and get a thrill from that. You know, you say, why are you even bringing it up? Well, because there's a major problem in that papal system of these dirty, rotten, filthy, stinking priests raping small children. There's a reason why. Their art depicts it. Here's another one, stained glass window. Again, look at lovingly looking into each other's eyes and kissing each other. Where is this at in the Bible? Where is there a priest with a tonsured haircut holding Jesus Christ as a little baby and kissing and snuggling with him and stuff like that? Where is this at? One more, just in case you weren't vexed enough. Again, you know, what is that? But now we'll go to the actual thing of another part of the whole scenario here, and that is their depiction of cherubim. And you can see here in this painting, here you have all the shepherds and stuff down here below, and real fancy, you know, stable that they're in there. But up above you have these naked babies with wings. I mean, that's in Scripture, isn't it? I mean, certainly there's naked babies with wings, you know, flying around in full nudity and stuff like that. I mean, where's this stuff at? And you say, well, those are cherub. They're cherubs. You know, that's what that is. That's a cherub. Let's actually see what the Bible, how the Bible describes a cherub. Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 4, we'll start there. It says, and I looked, and behold, a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud, and a fire enfolding itself, and a brightness was about it. And out of the midst thereof, as the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire. Also out of the midst thereof came the likeness of four living creatures, and this was their appearance. They had the likeness of a man, not a little baby. And every one had four faces, and every one had four wings. And their feet were straight feet, and the sole of their feet was like the sole of a calf's foot, and they sparkled like the collar of burnished brass. And they had the hands of a man under their wings on their four sides, and they four had their faces and their wings. Their wings were joined one to another. They turned not when they went. They went every one straight forward. Now look at this, verse 10. As for the likeness of their faces, they four had the face of a man and the face of a lion on the right side. So they all had the face of a man, but then the face of a lion over here. Okay, on the right side, and they four had the face of an ox on the left side, and they four also had the face of an eagle. Is that what a cherub looks like? I don't think so. No, I don't think so. And it says here, thus were their faces, and their wings were stretched upward. Two wings of every one were joined one to another, and two covered their bodies. Okay, and it keeps going on there. We're not going to read the whole thing. But you see this thing, this description of the appearance of cherubim. All right, and even back in the Old Testament, let me look up the reference here real quick. I think it's in, you know, well, 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 11 says, and he rode upon a cherub and did fly, and he was seen upon the wings of the wind. So How do you ride upon a small baby with these little dinky little wings? Okay. I mean, why is this stuff being depicted by the Roman Catholics? Kind of strange. I mean, if they're the ultimate expositors of Scripture, shouldn't they say, hey, whoa, wait a second here. This isn't accurate to the Bible. Here's another one. And, you know, see, I believe, you know, these little babies up here, and they're, you know, half of them, they got their naked rears and stuff like this, and you got other ones that they're laying there and their legs are spread apart. I mean, is this really something that should be depicted? And, of course, you have this famous one here, the two cherubs, you know, and they're like this, and the other one, you know. Chapter and verse, please. And again, naked cherubim, they're going to put a crown on Mary's head. Isn't that nice of them? You know, and you get these weird, sexless, winged things. They look like women, but, you know, they have, a lot of times, their arms and their legs are like men. See, the whole system of Roman Catholicism is messed up, and it's always been messed up. Okay, that's what I'm trying to get through to people. It isn't that, oh, now that they're praying to Lucifer, now they're messed up, but the pre-Vatican II Vatican, oh boy, they were good. No, they've always been bad. They've always been messed up. The system has always been against the Bible and true Bible-believing Christians. Always has been. Always will be until the Lord destroys Roman Catholicism in Revelation chapter 8, or 18, excuse me, which is in the future. The Catholics try to spiritualize that and put that in the past. And again, you see some more cherubim here, you know, naked in their, you know, I mean, just very inappropriate. So I think that's all the pictures I have right now. Yeah. But, you know, again, where's this stuff at in Scripture? See, it just, every single part, every facet of Roman Catholicism, when you study it, it's just so anti-scriptural. I mean, it's an unscriptural too. I mean, it's just like, where's this stuff coming from? You know? And you see this organization that's raping and molesting children into the thousands, probably millions by now, I'm sure, and just raping children, raping children, raping children. And there's stories about Benedict, you know, getting into human sacrifice and all kinds of stuff. I have no idea. It wouldn't shock me a bit, to be very frank. But the fact of the matter is, it's an epidemic among Catholicism. And I believe part of the reason is because they've been depicting naked children in their paintings for centuries. And no biblical support for it. I'd get out of that system if I was you. If you're watching this thing and you're a Roman Catholic, I'd run away from that system quickly. Okay? There is no biblical support for the Mass. I covered that. I showed it from the Douay Rheims translation. Okay? Eating the flesh and drinking the blood of Almighty God is very disgusting, and it's cannibalism. It's forbidden in Scripture to drink blood. Okay? When Jesus Christ talked about it, it was merely symbolic. Obviously, because he had his literal blood there, nobody came up and drank of it. So it could not have been literal. It was symbolic. Anybody who's honest is going to come away with that conclusion. Okay? Mary in the Bible was a sinner who needed a Savior. She had multiple children. Okay? Jesus was merely the firstborn. And Joseph didn't know her until after she brought forth her firstborn child. So, again, everything about Catholicism is corrupt and crooked. Everything. You better get away from that system.